One of the most popular complaints about Hollywood today is that they don't take any risks. But I think after we go through my list of the top 10 wild cards for 2018, you'll agree that Tinseltown definitely still likes to gamble. But here's the thing. Sometimes it's a creative risk. Yay! But sometimes it's a totally unnecessary risk on talent, usually a director, that any savvy moviegoer would know is a bad bet. Sometimes Hollywood's just being Hollywood, but sometimes there's a reason, which we'll discuss here. But let's take a look at my list again of top 10 wild cards of 2018, part of a set. We've already done blockbusters, regular movies still to come. I can't think of a better term for that right now. But here are the wild cards, and in some cases, get ready to have a good laugh. All right, so number 10, Ocean's 8. How does Hunger Games director Gary Ross keep working? Well, I'll tell you why. He's a very savvy producer who finds great projects and then attaches himself to them as the director. Now, you think eventually he'd get tired of producing movies that don't do so well or would have done better if he hadn't directed them. But so maybe there's a Gary Ross in the future where he lets someone else direct. But for now, he goes to the studios with this great idea, first Hunger Games, now an all-female Ocean's 11, although with just 8. And he says, if you want this, you have to let me direct. And so that puts the studios in a very difficult position of having to either pass or work with Gary as a director. And right now, there's always a studio who will take that risk. It turned out pretty darn well for Lionsgate, and obviously Warner Brothers is hoping for the same with what could potentially, though, be their very own Ghostbusters. Why would anybody want that? Well, while Ghostbusters seemed a bit too TV with the casting, although you can see what they were going for there because the original did pull largely from Saturday Night Live, but this Ocean's 8 cast, well, this is a very movie star-studded cast, no doubt, which has certainly piqued a lot of people's interest so far and has not garnered the hate that Ghostbusters did out of the gate, so that's promising. Plus, in the current era of Me Too, hashtag Me Too, this could be brilliant counter-programming in a blockbuster-riddled summer, although this is technically, I guess, supposed to be a blockbuster. It's certainly high concept and meant to make a lot of money. We'll see if it does. Although on a side note, first Ghostbusters and now Ocean's 8, they keep messing up of not having the strong, you know, there it was a single female role, well, they don't have the single male role in the remakes. It's such an obvious mistake, it frustrates me that they keep making it. All right, so anyway, number 9, New Mutants. Josh Boone has only directed 2 movies, and they were both romantic. One a romantic comedy, one an epic romantic weepy, which gave us Ansel Elgort, and prolonged Shailene Woodley's career, although she keeps sticking her own foot in her mouth. But anyway, Josh Boone feels that despite that being his resume, he's got a horror film somewhere inside of him, deep inside of him. And Fox believes him because they're allowing him to make this New Mutants movie. And it is indeed an intriguing idea until you remember that Legion, which is superb, which we know is superb, has struggled in the ratings. But they're gonna try it anyway. Fox is gonna try this. But I have to say, with so many superhero shows on television, can a smaller superhero movie get audiences to pay to go out to the theater, right? It's a tough call, and there's even a rumor that if the Disney-Fox merger goes through, this is supposed to be a trilogy, and the second 2 movies could go straight to the Disney streaming service. But it could be a huge hit, and it'll certainly be assisted by its cast, which is very strong here, with fan favorites from Split, Stranger Things, and of course, Game of Thrones. All right, number 8, Crazy Rich Asians. As more and more Asians flourish behind the camera, how about in front of the camera? Rose Tico was a controversial yet big move. The jury's still out on how that worked out. But here's a legit move to try and start down the path that's taken quote unquote black film and talent so far. Ken Jeong, Michelle Yeoh, Harry Shum Jr., and Awkwafina bring some kind of star power. It's a little light on star power, let's be honest. And Constance Wu, whoa, it's her chance to step up and prove herself after she was so tough on whitewashing on social media about a year or so ago. She really put it out there, and so I think that raises the stakes for her personally. And if this works, a lot of careers could be jump-started here, including Constance Wu's. But if it doesn't work out, will it hurt whitewashing complaints about adapting anime and manga, particularly going forward? And it's all in the hands of John Chu. All in the hands of John Chu! All right, so number 7, that ties in with Love, Simon, because I'm sure the LGBT community would like a stronger director instead of CW poster boy Greg Berlanti behind Love, Simon. But I think there is something to be said for these directors, and that they're the ones who are willing to roll the dice, right? They're the ones willing to make these movies. And they deserve points for that, unless they ruin them, and then it'll be some kind of help is the kind of help we can do without. But anyway, Jurassic World's Nick Robinson stars, and I couldn't find out if he's actually from the LGBT community himself or not. That's his own personal business. But of course, if he's not, that could open the film to some criticism. But he looks like he's doing a fantastic job in what is Hollywood's first mainstream LGBT romantic comedy. A lot of LGBT films out there, but again, I want to stress that this is mainstream and intentionally John Hughes-esque. And so far, it looks pretty darn good. But the question is, how many tickets can it sell at the multiplex? All right, number 6, Teen Titans Go to the Movies. Oh, I think that's a very clever title. But I have to say that, well, for the most part, DC consistently kills it in animation. What's become of Teen Titans is deeply hated by fans of the original series. But somebody's watching the new show on Cartoon Network, and now it has its own movie, which is made, happily, by the people who make the show. So that's nice that the talent was brought over. There's some new talent attached, though. Will Lego Batman Arnett is not only providing a voice in the movie, but producing, and it will follow the Teen Titans as they decide to go to Hollywood to get their own superhero movie, as so many are being made. Again, I think it sounds hilarious, and it could be. Or it could be yet another black eye for DC Films, which some people would also find hilarious. Okay, number 5, another animated movie. There's a lot of animation on this list, and I think that's exciting that animation is taking so many chances. But number 5 is The Grinch. Now, people constantly underestimate Illumination Entertainment, the only animation studio outside of Disney Pixar to get into the $1 billion club twice. Now, some of you might argue whether or not it deserves that, but hey, the numbers don't lie. So it got into the $1 billion club, but The Lorax, one of the earlier films out of Illumination, didn't make anywhere near that amount of money. But still, it so impressed Dr. Seuss's widow that she gave the animation studio the exclusive rights to adapt his work going forward. And of course, they salivated at adapting The Grinch. But I think that's a risky move, because while the Jim Carrey, Ron Howard flick was originally trashed by critics and the media alike, it's still the second highest grossing Christmas movie of all time behind Home Alone. Plus, it's found a legion of fans, I think even more so over the years, and every year consistently on iTunes, it's one of the top rented and purchased Christmas movies. So I don't know if that's a fandom you want to mess with, but still, Benedict Cumberbatch voicing the Grinch, well, he brings a lot of fan cred himself. So we'll see if audiences will let this new Grinch into their hearts, or if it's 3 sizes too small for it. All right, number 4, Alita Battle Angel. And speaking of whitewashing, here's another manga adaptation with no Asian leads. Can Robert Rodriguez and James Cameron succeed where Ghost in the Shell failed? Although I think it helps right off the bat that they're not Rupert Sanders. And this is a rare entry on this list where the behind-the-camera talent is the safety net rather than the risk. Now, this female action version of Pinocchio might turn mainstream audiences off with its heroine's exaggerated features, particularly those anime eyes. But perhaps a cult audience will appreciate that she's supposed to look unrealistic as she's literally a doll. And a lot of dolls at the store today look like this. And with a budget of $175 to $200 million, it should not only look amazing, but have some amazing action sequences. Again, especially with Rodriguez and Cameron involved. Rodriguez is directing, while Cameron is producing and helped with the script. Although with that price tag, whoo, this sure is a wild card, right? All right, so number 3. Red Sparrow. Now, a number of actresses have hurt their careers, some of them never to recover, trying to go the sexy route. And we'll see if Jennifer Lawrence can succeed where they failed. Emma Stone is currently crawling her way back, and I think doing a good job of it. But, you know, she really, you know, took a detour there that wasn't necessary. Now, with Jennifer Lawrence here, she's reteaming with her Hunger Games director, Francis Lawrence, who took over for Gary Ross after they kicked him out after that first movie. That's how bad a job he did. Although Francis Lawrence ultimately didn't fare much better because that franchise didn't end on a high note. And Jennifer Lawrence had further bad luck with, well, Joy underperformed at the box office. Mother was a complete disaster, not even resulting in any nominations for her, at least so far. We'll see if the Oscars can save her at the last moment. And then also Mystique. She has really angered fans with her comments and the way she's treated that franchise. And also, I think now, with the fact that she won't go away, right? She doesn't like it. Nobody likes her in the role. Yet why is she still here? Anyway, none of these things have put her in a great position to go into Red Sparrow. But we all know that it can take just one amazing movie to win everybody back, and maybe this is it. Number two, Venom. And with comedic director Ruben Fleischer at the helm, I am convinced that Sony feels that this is their answer to Deadpool, and it very well could be. Because not only is Fleischer directing, but Tom Hardy, well, let's just say the only good thing to come out of this means war, he has comedic talent as well. And this movie not only stars Tom Hardy, but Michelle Williams, Riz Ahmed, Woody Harrelson, and Jenny Slate. They wouldn't sign on for a stinker, would they? This is indeed a very intriguing film, but I think the bottom line is that everybody's wondering if Sony can deliver a good Spidey movie without Marvel's help. I feel that they can, and I'm very excited about what's happening at Sony within the Spider-Man or the Spider-Verse, a hint as to what number one is, specifically. Because both of my top two wild card movies for the year are not only from Sony, but they're also from their Spidey movies. Side note, how exciting is it that Sony could really turn things around in 2018, right? They had a surprise win with Jumanji, not only a box office success, but an unexpected thorn in the side of Star Wars. Jumanji challenging the Star Wars brand. So they could really be, talk about a wild card, it could be Sony themselves. But anyway, as I'm sure you've guessed by now, number one for me on the wild cards list is Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. This looks so amazingly good, but I'm also so scared for it. So right now, everyone's talking about T'Challa, as they should be, but I hope by the end of the year, everyone's talking about Miles Morales. But we're on pins and needles here to see if the mainstream will accept a Spider-Man of color. Black Panther is an original character who started out as a superhero of color, whereas Miles Morales has always had to battle people who don't like seeing the race bending with Spider-Man. Although it's a different guy in the suit. It's not race-bending Peter Parker, but this has been a real problem for the character. Undeservedly so, I think. I think that this is very organically done. I've loved Miles Morales from the very beginning when Brian Michael Bendis introduced him in the Marvel comics. I haven't seen him on the animated series, the animated Ultimate Spider-Man series, but I'm very, very excited for what's happening with this movie, because not only do I like Miles Morales, but it's finally here. A sophisticated animated film from the West, from Hollywood, not from the East, not from Asia, that is aimed at adults as much as kids. That is incredibly exciting, not just for animation, but for Hollywood in general. This could be a real game changer. And I have to say, the film looks absolutely amazing. Plus, it would be sweet revenge for Phil Lord and Chris Miller after recently being fired off of the Han Solo movie for being too bold, having too many of their own crazy ideas. Well, here's an opportunity to show that they have the right crazy ideas. Now, I already feel this is going to be a fabulous movie, that the first trailer was spectacular, but I do worry if mainstream audiences will pay to see it in theaters. And if they don't, what direction that could lead the conversation in. So we have a mix here. We have a mix of directors. We don't know why anybody would place their faith in them. And then we also have a lot of bold moves here that, if they aren't accepted, could be problematic down the line for groups that are hoping for a little bit of better representation in mainstream entertainment. All right, so that's my list of the top 10 wild cards of 2018. Which gambles do you think are a good bet, and which do you think are a bad bet? Write your thoughts down below. Thank you so much for going over this list with me. And as always, you can check out some more videos, including my list of the top 10 blockbusters for 2018 right now.